And the paradigm now in Africa is for economic transformation. And if we look around in terms of how we get this economic transformation, one of our biggest assets, as I've said, is our land and agriculture. And so in that sense, agriculture becomes a very critical driver, could become a very critical driver for our economic transformation. We could use it to add value to what we produce, to diversify the types of products that we produce, and also to use it as a starting steps into industrialization through agro-processing. So for Africa, agriculture is very important. So we are gathered here today to see what the trade facilitation agreement could do to help Africa move in this direction of using agriculture as a driver for economic transformation. But we also know that to be able to trade, first you need to be able to produce efficiently. You need to be able to carry the goods within the country to the port efficiently before you get to the port and the clearing exercises, which trade facilitation is about. And you also need to have market access and to be able to deal with regulations. So the trade facilitation then is nested in within a broader long chain of what's needed in order to turn agriculture into a driver of Africa's transformation. So the issue is, to what extent is this agreement something that could be leveraged into for agriculture to become a driver of Africa's economic transformation? What more needs to be done? Should African countries ratify this trade facilitation agreement and then do other things in order to get the package right for agriculture to become a driver of transformation? Should they wait until other things are in place? What are those other things? And what are the issues that we need to take into account to really make realize the goal of agriculture becoming a driver of Africa's economic transformation? And we are very lucky to have a panel of eminent experts who have spent either in their day-to-day activities or in terms of their own studies, are eminently qualified to speak on this issue. We first have Professor Bernard Hockman. Please come up as I mention your name. Professor Bernard Hockman, who is now at the university in Italy, spent a long career both in the bank and the WTO, working on WTO issues. Welcome, Bernard. We also have Ms. Lucy Muchoki from Kenya, who is a representative of the Kenya Agribusiness Association and is directly involved in promoting Kenya's agriculture as a driver of Kenya's economic transformation. And welcome, Lucy. And also we have Mr. Otin Jesse, an eminent businessman from Ghana, a former chairman of the Ghana Manufacturers Association, who in his day-to-day life is also wrestles with these issues. We had also in the panel two representatives who we are hoping will show up. First, the Dutch Minister for Trade and Economic Cooperation. She has been tied up, and her first minister or director general, we're expecting her, but apparently he's been stuck in traffic. And also the Rwanda Minister for Trade and Industry. We assume that he's also stuck in the negotiations. He may show up or have somebody represent him. But we'll carry on with the panel that's already here. So what we'll do is I'll give for about 5 to 10 minutes to each panelist to speak on the issue, and then we open it up to discussion. And in Bernard, in particular, given your overall view of the WTO process and the issues and all the challenges, maybe you could start by giving us a good overview of where we are in the WTO and where the TFA fits and what are the key issues that you see. And then we can go to Lucy, and then you can tell us from your point of view as a representative of the agribusiness in Kenya, and you also have experiences outside of Kenya in Africa, and you give us your view, and then from the manufacturer's point of view, Tony, you can give us, and then we can open it to the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Joel. So the topic of this session is kind of leveraging the trade facilitation agreement for agriculture, and that's what I'll speak to in most of my time. But just to step back a bit and think about where is agriculture in the context of the WTO process, you know, obviously agriculture is very important for many African countries. At the same time, agriculture is not all that important for many higher income countries. That, of course, is one of the reasons we're not making much progress, I think, in the Doha negotiations. If you think about where we are today relative to where we were in 2001, clearly the number of countries that have kind of dramatically changed their agricultural policies, there's been a lot of change on that front, right? When the negotiations started, it was very much a focus on the EU and the US and Japan, a very kind of traditional agenda in the sense that it's been around for many decades, trying to reduce trade exporting agricultural support to farmers in those countries. Where we are today, we have a number of emerging economies that are also very actively supporting agriculture, and that is, of course, as all of you in this room no doubt know, that is one of the reasons why it's become very difficult to actually move forward on agriculture in the Doha negotiations. On the trade facilitation front, I think, you know, clearly it's very important for the trade facilitation agreement not only to be ratified, but much more important actually to be implemented by countries, right? And there's no reason not to implement the provisions of that agreement even if you haven't formally ratified it. And why does this matter for agriculture? And I would argue it matters very importantly for agriculture on a number of dimensions. One is if you have high trade costs, if it's very difficult or it takes a lot of time, or even more important, there's a lot of variability in the time it takes to get goods across the border. That obviously matters much more for a good that is perishable than for a good that is not. And in the agricultural context, especially if we're talking about higher value products, fresh fruit, vegetables, horticulture, clearly that is something that matters a lot in terms of the price you're going to get on average if you confront a very variable system as opposed to one which is predictable and you know where things are going to happen. So one immediate importance of trade facilitation is it's going to lower trade costs for farmers in Africa. So that's one immediate benefit. I think another benefit, so that's in economic speak, you know, that's kind of benefits along the intensive margin. So you're already trading something, the costs of what you're trading go down, profits are going to increase for farmers in Africa. There's also another dimension, which I think is also important, is there's probably a lot of products that are not being traded because those trade costs are high. So on the extensive margin, as economists would say, kind of new products, new markets, that's where a lot of the gains are going to come from if we can again bring trade costs down through trade facilitation measures. There's also direct implications for poverty. Right, so a lot of trade in Africa tends to be informal at the moment. If we can reduce the costs for those traders, day traders, informal traders, that's going to directly feed through into higher incomes for the people who are doing that. Those people, of course, tend to be poor. So therefore, there's a very direct link, I think, also to the poverty reduction agenda in terms of trade facilitation. The final, I think, kind of dimension of trade facilitation and agriculture, why it's important, is there's a lot of food waste along the logistics chain, right? So a lot of the food that actually gets harvested is wasted in terms of the process of getting it from the field into a processing center, into wherever it's going to go in terms of final distribution. And the estimates, the research in this area shows that, you know, the wastage rates can be very, very high. Now, obviously, this depends a lot on transport infrastructure. It depends on the availability of storage facilities and so forth. But all of that is kind of, you can put that under the umbrella, the broad umbrella of trade facilitation. So one of the big benefits of more efficient trade facilitation is less waste. Okay, final point, And I think this gets more to the bigger picture, or not the final point, but another dimension of why it matters, is if you think back and if you look at the statistics in terms of the balance between production and trade in the 1960s, 70s for Africa. Africa used to be a net exporter of food. Today, Africa is a huge net importer of food, so there's also huge potential for intra-regional trade and agricultural products and foodstuffs within Africa. And that is, again, very much a trade facilitation agenda, right? So if it costs a lot to get food from one country to another, you're not going to see that type of transactions happening. So I think that is, again, another potential benefit from trade facilitation. I think trade facilitation is a necessary condition, really, for moving towards improving the trade balance in agricultural products for African countries. Now, one point I would like to emphasize here is that although the focus with the WTO is very much on the trade facilitation agreement, that agreement only deals with a small part of what I would call the trade facilitation agenda. And especially for agriculture, the logistics part of the equation is particularly important. So we need to be thinking about distribution, we need to be thinking about cold storage facilities, we need to be thinking about transport. None of which is affected by the trade facilitation agreement. So I think just to echo what Yaw said at the beginning, we need to think about trade facilitation in a broader agenda. And I think what that means in terms of operationalizing or leveraging the trade facilitation agreement, which I think is the title of this session, you know, you really need to use, I would argue, that points then towards using the institutions that are going to be set up for implementing that agreement to actually think about that broader agenda. Right, so if we have, every country is supposed to put in place a national trade facilitation committee to implement the agreement, I would argue, especially from an agriculture point of view, is to make sure you actually have the other actors as part of that mechanism to say, okay, we can actually raise agricultural specific issues, which often I think will have to do with things like logistics, but at the same time, that might be a good mechanism to at least ensure that these issues are being addressed. So just as another example, if we're thinking about agricultural trade, sanitary, phytosanitary standards are going to be a big kind of factor in terms of being able to trade. That's not part of the trade facilitation agreement, but I think we should do what we can to actually bring those issues into those mechanisms so that they can be addressed. Final point is I think it's important to mention the fact that, you know, within Africa, if we think about boosting and bolstering intra-Africa trade and agricultural products, for which I think there is big potential, we also need to think about traditional trade policies, right? And I think it is still the case that many countries tend to be rather quick at imposing export restrictions in times when there is a shortage in a particular region or country. So again, that inhibits trade across African borders. So that, you know, I would also argue needs to be kind of focused on. It's not just about trade facilitation, lowering costs. It's also basically about allowing farmers to export their goods to neighboring markets. And again, that being predictable, that you actually know what the regime is going to be. So a whole bunch of issues there. But I would come back again to this issue of the institutional mechanisms that are going to be put in place to implement the agreement. And I think the more we can do to actually leverage that, to actually deal with agricultural trade issues, the better off we're going to be in terms of leveraging the trade agreement, the trade facilitation agreement. Thanks.
Thank you, Bernard. As I said at during my introduction, we've now been joined by the DG, the Vice Minister for Trade and Cooperation of the Netherlands. And I must say that we are very happy to be, in fact, co-sponsoring this panel with the Netherlands Ministry of Trade and Development. As you know, as Africa begins to try to see how agriculture can power transformation, the Netherlands is a country that we can learn a lot from, because this is a country where agriculture and horticulture plays a very critical role in the economy, and they do have a lot of expertise, and they are already also very much involved in the African continent, so there's a lot that we can learn from. Beyond that, I think the Netherlands, and in particular the ministry in particular, has taken a very leading role in trying to advance the cause of Africa in this WTO negotiation. So welcome, Vice Minister, and we really appreciate the support and the leadership that you're showing. and also in particular also the support for my institution, I said. Why don't we get you settled in and we have Lucy talk and then we'll come back to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Yeo. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Lucy Muchoki, as you were told. I represent Kenya Agribusiness and Agro Industry Alliance and member of KEPSA, part of the KEPSA Agricultural Board. That's for the Kenyans. You all know what KEPSA stands for. As for the guests, I also represent the task force for organizing the African agribusiness. This is in line with what we call the Malabo Declaration, which is an affirmation of the what we call Maputo Declaration, which formed the CADAP, the Comprehensive African Agriculture Development Program, which clearly stipulates how we are going to do agriculture in Africa. For those who don't know about CADAP, and I keep on saying we all need to start by having the knowledge. Knowledge is very important. Even before we start talking about the issues that we have been brought here on WTO, we need to first understand what is it that we are saying as Africans? What is it we have committed to do as Africans? Now, this point is very important to me. The fact that the African government have committed to put 10% minimum of their budget allocation to agriculture. Very few governments up to today, and we're talking of since year 2003, where the governments committed to do this. How many governments in Africa up to today have managed to achieve that? Very few. Now, this leads me to the discussion of today, that if at all we have to improve our transformation, agricultural transformation, it starts with us being committed in what we have planned to do. And we need to take our governments to task. What are they doing to support our own agro-processing, especially the SMEs? And I want to spend a bit of time discussing about agro-processing for SMEs, because this is where the agricultural transformation, the economical transformation for Africa will be achieved. It is through the SMEs development. We all know that there's a big potential, but why aren't we transforming our SMEs in Africa today? Just before, there was a panel here, and my Minister for Industrialization was seated here. And 2 weeks ago, we had a big meeting where we brought together all these SMEs, and the issues were the same. It's about market access, it's about capacity development, it's about finance. All of us know, we all know about this. So why aren't we doing this? What is stopping us from doing what we already know? I think we need to challenge ourselves as Africans and start looking at why we are not getting further. We have been talking about intra-African trade. I know that, of course, it's very expensive. We need to all look at infrastructure. This, we have started talking about it for a long time. I think the time for talk in Africa is now over. We want to see action. And our partners, the Western, have been here. We are talking. I think this is a very good start. The people are talking with one another. We have time to discuss, to talk. But we want to tell them, and we want to tell our partners from the Western world, that we are ready to do business. What we want to do is to partner with you. And we want to do a win-win situation. We want to win together. It's only Africa which is growing at a higher rate economically. And also, our population is rising day by day. We know that by the end of this century, Africa is going to constitute 40% of the population of the world. So this is where the market is. So we are calling our Western partners, come and invest. We want to facilitate your investment. We want to discuss those issues and we invest together. And I'm sure this is the way forward for all of us. Looking at the issue of knowledge, there's a big gap in the knowledge management in Africa. There's a lot of good information out there. I've been with ASSET before, discussing about very important documentation and analysis on some agro-processing commodities within East Africa. I remember when I looked at that document and I shared it with my CS, the cabinet secretary, he was amazed. And he said, "Well, Lucy, where do you get all this kind of information from?" So, I mean, it's very interesting that we can have all this kind of information with us, but how come we are not being able to share among ourselves information that will be able to lead us, will be able to help us develop our continent? I think in all, what we need to do is let's share information, let's look for platforms, let's look for networks that brings the value that we are looking for. Information is power. Lastly, I want to talk about technologies. It's sad that up to today, we're still really lagging behind in the technology adaptation. And things are not going to wait for us. Trade is taking place. We want to negotiate and we want to tell our partners, please listen to us. We want to be at your level. We want to trade with you. But also try and be fair with us, because what we want is a fair trading platform. Let's trade, but let's be fair, because we know that you are ahead of us, but we want to work with you. So what we want to do is, how can we be able to pick up the technologies? How can we be able to share these technologies and be able to do business and ease the doing business? I know right now, in Kenya specifically, because I come from Kenya, I know that we're working day and night looking at that infrastructure. I was talking to a colleague about the Northern Corridor. Every day, the president talks Northern Corridor. He wants to see us opening the Northern Corridor, which is connecting Kenya, Rwanda, Burundi, Sudan, Ethiopia. I think this is the way forward. If all of us look at the positive side of doing and opening business through building the infrastructure, I really believe that this is really going to be critical for all of us. And I believe our brothers also from West Africa are looking at their corridor, the Trans-Africa, and we are going to connect. Let's try and all of us put the efforts and look and talk to our governments and insist on ensuring that this infrastructure become the key. Because in the end of the day, we need to trade with ourselves. Because this is where the trade is going to be. It's about intra-African trade. Even if we still need to trade with our Western countries, let us also do our intra-African trade. Let us take the policies that support us, to do business among ourselves, not banning the trade between ourselves. I'll be very happy to see the day when I'll be able to come and sell my goods to Nigeria or to Ghana freely. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lucy. Minister, if you don't mind, let's go to another African operator, and then you can then bring the international perspective to it before we go. So, Tony.
Hello. Yeah, thank you. Let me just say, by way of introduction, I was introduced as somebody in manufacturing, which is very, very true. But what I'd like to bring to this perspective is that of a peasant farmer. Because a few years ago, I actually inherited several farms. You know, in Ghana, we have this inheritance scheme where you inherit from your uncle. And several farms have become my own. So imagine me not in tie and things, but every once 3 or 4 months, going to the village to see these farms, cocoa farms, food farms. And I go just like a peasant farmer. So my perspective is that from me as a peasant farmer, going to the farm every day, how does trade facilitation help me? The first thing I'd like to bring is that my experience from the few years that I have been a peasant farmer, as it were, looking, brings me to the straight conclusion that the first problem facing the African farmer is one of production. From things like irrigation and even the land tenure system and all those things which we need to resolve and resolve as fast as possible. Those are the primary concerns of an African farmer. Even when you get into trade facilitation, the normal things that African farmer is looking for are things like the road network, the cold chain network, how he can get his goods to his local market, to the nearest big town where he can sell his goods, even before he thinks about export and he thinks about getting to the national capital or to an airport or to a harbor. So those are the immediate trade facilitation requirements of the typical African farmer. The third point I'd like to make is that if we don't resolve these issues and we go ahead and make trade facilitation the way that is planned in the document, the trade facilitation agreement, and it is a very, very good agreement. But what we should realize is that it is not only for farming. It is for all businesses. So it applies to me as a manufacturer of something else. I manufacture electric cables. And it will help me very much because border controls, customs duties, and all those things are taken care of. But as a peasant farmer, unfortunately, if I'm not helped to improve my production and my productivity and all those things, we may end up with a situation where the trade facilitation will actually hurt me. How will it hurt me? It will hurt me because all of a sudden, farm produce from other places where farming is more efficient will arrive in my village at a cheaper price and in better quantities than what I can produce. So what is meant to actually help the farmer could end up hurting the farmer. Unless, and this is a call to African governments, that if African governments don't sit up and spend even more than the 10% that Lucy is talking about and help their farmers to grow and to farm in a much more efficient manner, agreements like this, which are coming up, will end up hurting the people they are intended to support. Let me make one final point concerning one other way in which trade facilitation, in fact, the trade facilitation agreement as presently constituted, can be improved even further to help not just African farmers, but even all African businesses. We know that for most African governments, a major source of revenue is import duty. Well, one of the biggest challenges African governments face is that of under-invoicing and over-invoicing, depending on which side you are looking at, and the fact that it affects the duty collections. If our trade facilitation arrangements, and the agreement I saw, unfortunately, does not cover an arrangement where whatever the exporter in whichever country reports to his exporting authorities as the value and the volume of whatever he's exporting, is also reported to the importing country that this is the value and this is the volume, so that they can actually calculate import duty on a reasonable basis, on an accurate basis, in fact, and not be subject to over and under invoicing, we could also end up in a situation where it's going to hurt even government revenue. So if the trade facilitation agreement, I think, should also look at the reporting of values and volumes of whatever is traded in order to help calculation of import duty. That's something which I think will help African governments. Thank you. We'll come back.
Thank you very much, very much. From the practitioner's point of view, and our minister, give us your view from the Netherlands, also as somebody who's been following the global process.
Okay. Well, thank you very much, and good morning, everybody. Apologize for being a little bit late. We got a small traffic problem in the city. I think agriculture, as was mentioned by the other members of this panel, is, of course, extremely important for Africa. And in that respect, the Netherlands has a very large role in the agricultural world. If you look at the Netherlands, it's quite a small country, but we're still the second largest exporter in agricultural products worldwide. So we have a lot of expertise and a lot of knowledge about agriculture. And well, if you look to the African situation, I think TFA is very relevant, trade facility agreements, and we still hope that we can be more ambitious and more countries will ratify the TFA. But I very much agree with Bernard, it's not only about TFA. There are so many other issues extremely relevant, because in the end you want to export your agricultural products and you definitely need much more than only the TFA. And also for the intra-African trade, which is extremely relevant too, you need also much more than only TFA. You do have to look to the whole chain of the agricultural products, which of course starts with the production. But it's also very relevant, all the services around it, to develop your cold chain, to develop your infrastructure needs. If you don't take the whole picture, you don't think you will be very successful in agricultural exports. So it's really much more than only the TFA what is very relevant. If we look to the Netherlands in Africa, we are very active. We are active in, for example, Trademark East Africa. We are trying to launch initiatives in West Africa on trade promotion. But we are also active with support in knowledge and expertise. We have our university, Wageningen, very active in many African countries to share their expertise and knowledge with African farmers on the production side. But we also have a lot of companies sharing their expertise on the service side, on the infrastructure, on the cold chain. How do you organize a cold chain in the agricultural chain, which is extremely relevant? I mean, if you produce good vegetables or good flowers, but you're not able to export them to European markets, even if you have access to those European markets, you will not be very successful. So you really need to take the whole chain. And if you look also, we see quite a few Dutch companies very successful in Africa. So I absolutely agree that you can be very successful as a private investor in Africa. We do see a lot of African Dutch farmers successful in Africa, but also Dutch companies in services and trade, for example, in flowers, in roses, but also in vegetables. And they try also to support local farmers and local companies to upgrade their standards so they are able also to export to either other African markets but also to the European markets. So I think that's very relevant. But if you want to attract foreign investors, it's not only about agricultural markets, it's also a broader agenda you need to become attractive for a foreign investor. And then I think there are huge opportunities in Africa. And I agree, there are so many. If you look to growth figures in Africa, but also look to the opportunities in the agricultural markets of Africa and opportunities for exports, I think they are huge. And I think also in the private sector in Holland, they see those opportunities. I'm very much happy to look for opportunities in African countries. But again, you really need the whole picture, the whole agenda, from production to services to trade, and also to the facilitation of trade to other countries and special European markets. And in the end, also to be able to meet those European standards. And in that respect, I think what leads Dutch companies, but also Wageningen University, is really looking to share the expertise so you can upgrade your products for African markets, but also for European or Asian or American markets. So to conclude, I think there's a huge potential. You need to work on the whole chain, so not only trade facilitation. And I think there are a lot of Dutch companies and private initiatives to assist African private companies and organizations to further improve their production, but also the way they organize their cold chain. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. Thank you, the rest of the panelists. I think what comes out very clear from almost all the panelists is that the TFE, as good as it is just as far as it goes. But you need to embed that in the whole supply chain in order for it to be fully taken advantage of. So the question is how to do that, and then how does that then also affect Africa's ratification or not of the treaty, and if they do, what should they be asking the development partners? What should they be doing themselves? As Lucy very forcefully and agree with her put, we need to take the matters responsibility, then we can have our friends to also help us. There's also the issue that if you look at the negotiations in agriculture now, it's now no longer between the North and the South. Even among the developing countries, there are now emerging markets that also have the same subsidization of their farmers as the North has, and so there are issues. The interests on the developing countries don't always necessarily converge as they used to, so there are issues there too. I'll throw it to the floor to ask questions, comments, contributions to the discussion. We start from, please, when you get up, just introduce yourself and then ask your question. And then see if there's directed at any particular panelist, please indicate that. Okay. There's somebody at the back and then you.
Yeah. Good morning, everybody. I want to thank the panelists for their very useful contribution to the topic of this morning. I want to come back to the theme of this session, agricultural transformation and trade facilitation. As one of the panelists mentioned, my brother from Ghana, agricultural transformation is about two elements: the sustained productivity increase of the small-scale farmers and the sustained income increase of the same. So when we have these two, then we can talk about agricultural transformation in Africa. The productivity increase is dependent on the availability and access to agricultural inputs, which in general, coming from Mali, I'm from Mali, these are imported. The fertilizers and other inputs are imported from neighboring countries. And there are a lot of red tapes and barriers to the import of these materials. What I want to emphasize on is when we reach the productivity increase of the small-scale farmers, this will trigger production increase, and agricultural sector will shed labor to the secondary sector, which is manufacturing, and the tertiary sector, which is services. Agribusiness and agro-industries, if those are not developed, forget about Africa transformation, agricultural transformation. These are the sector which will employ the vast majority of our demographic dividend and so forth, and create jobs and so forth. So we should look at what goes on in Africa first before we reach out to the rest of the world. If we manage to increase agribusiness and agro-industry, we'll think about exporting those products in between us. So the inter-Africa trade, that's what we should look at first before we reach to the rest of the world. If Africa can trade with himself, with itself, I want to say, the trade, inter-Africa trade percentage will move from the 12-14% that we are talking about today to 30% that we are dreaming about for the intra-Asian countries and intra-American countries. So what I want to conclude with, the trade facilitation that we are talking about, let's do it within Africa first before we reach the rest of the world. Thank you.
Thank you. And so you don't have any question for the panelists? Just a comment. Okay, thanks. Okay, please. Go ahead. Short introduction of yourself and then...
I'm Benson Kaduli from East African Trade Review. My question, I think, is directed to the peasant farmer. One question: when do you intend to change from a peasant farmer to a commercial farmer. In essence, I'm saying, when do we expect to see a transformation of African agriculture from peasant farming into commercialization? And probably it may not be the case in Ghana, but there is a sense in it. If you own a small, probably small pieces here and there, then there is a problem. Tenure system, land tenure system. Lucy, in Kenya, honestly, we have above that percent that is arable, but we have actually fragmented the same to understand that it is, in some cases and in some areas, it is totally unproductive. It is actually now the farmers who need food, who needs food aid, and yet they wake up every morning to go to the farm. Even before we talk about trade, we have issues about food security. So in this kind of a situation, with the African government you are talking about, they will pump money. But none of them have the political will to address the land tenure system. Stop fragmenting farm, mechanize the farms, and make it more productive. That will not take trade facilitation. It will take commitment of African governments. They do it, or else we will not get out of the pit. Thank you.
President Farmer, yeah, why don't you see what do you intend to change?
Yeah, thank you. I think that you have answered the question very, very, very well. You know, when I took over these farms, one of my first ideas was to get a surveyor, survey all the farms, let me look at the location. I came to it from educated person's point of view, you know. Why do we have to go different directions to get to? Can I consolidate the farms, even trade off some land for somebody else's land? The land tenure system in Ghana is in a mess. And that one, no individual African peasant farmer can do anything about it. It is up to policymakers. No Western government can help do it. It's up to Ghana government and African governments. So we ourselves need to have our own agricultural revolution from within our own countries. Maybe we can learn from examples of other places like Netherlands or Europe. But then you say the political will has to come from our people, and we need to get that. The danger, like I mentioned, is that if we don't do it and do it fast, the food aid, which even the farmer is getting now, will get even worse. So we don't have the luxury of time anymore. The gentleman who talked about the need for trade, bringing in agric inputs, trade facilitation will actually help bring in fertilizer. It will help when you try to move fertilizer from Ghana to Nigeria, there are 30 stops if you are going by road. So it just doesn't work. A road distance which will be done in one day, it will take you 2 weeks from Accra to Lagos. It just doesn't work. Trade facilitation will also help intra-African trade. And so the earlier we get at it, the better it is for all of us.
Okay. Any of the panelists want to come in? Yeah.
Thank you very much. Just, I think, one observation I really would like to make, because I very much agree with you, that most of the time, even also in the Netherlands, if we talk about trade, we talk about exports, and we forget imports. I mean, they're as relevant as exports, as fertilizer. I mean, if you want to, you need fertilizer. Most of the countries, a lot of countries have to import them. So I fully agree that trade facilitation is not only about exports, it's very much also about imports. And well, the other question about the issues of shifting labor to other sectors, of course, if you increase productivity, which is extremely relevant, then of course you labor has to shift to other sectors like services or manufacturing. And that requires also policies for those sectors to develop. And that's very relevant also, I think, for many African countries.
Okay. Anybody wants to add? Go to here and then you. Okay.
So one additional thought on the productivity dimension. I think there's huge scope. Yes, there's huge scope for increasing productivity, and I think it's very important to increase productivity. of farming, but at the same time, that doesn't necessarily have to imply in the short run large movements of workers away to other sectors, because that sector, the agricultural sector itself, can expand, right? And I think here there is, and again, this is not something that is going to apply everywhere, but I think linking in to international value chains and connecting to, you know, large retailers in other markets, that is a way of really boosting output a lot. So in a sense, that's also going to create more demand for labor. And, you know, there's been a fair amount, I think, of evidence already in Africa itself of examples of where this is happening, where you actually bring in large numbers of smallholder farmers who are then connected to these chains. And I think that is another part of the policy story where you need to facilitate that type of process. But I fully agree that obviously, if we think about, and again, if we're limiting this just to trade facilitation, national trade facilitation, regional trade facilitation is obviously, I think, very much a priority. I mean, if a farmer can't get his output to the local market, everything stops. So I fully agree with Tony on this.
Okay. Thank you. Back there? Yeah, please.
Thank you. I'm Hiramani from Nepal. I have a question on the first presentation. Despite the importance of TFA in agriculture, but also in many other areas, we don't see a lot of enthusiasm on the part of the government in terms of ratifying the agreement. So I'm wondering whether you could offer some thoughts on why the governments are taking a rather cautious approach in ratifying the agreement.
Yeah, question is, if the TFA is so good, how come nobody is taking it up? Only about 6 African countries have taken it up. And in total, so far, the last I checked, it's only about 57 countries, one-third of the WTO membership have taken it up. So let me take one question. Why Bernard Espert is collecting his thoughts on this? Go ahead.
I'm Vishragi from the University of Northern Iowa. I've had the distinct honor of being able to work with women in both Ghana and Kenya in basic agricultural areas, as well as in Nicaragua and Central America. And I totally agree that we need infrastructure, we need the ability to move things back and forth, and we need the regulations. But one of the things that is very apparent to me as I work with the women's groups, and I was up in Meru when I worked here, and then in Ghana I worked in the Kumasi region and the Aflao region, both with programs on developing. If many of the women could not even write their own name to be able to sign anything to be able to go and get traditional banking. One of the exercises I did here in Kenya was looking at, were they making money on what they were doing? And I would draw a cow, and we would put in the inputs to that cow to produce a calf and to produce milk and all those costs, and then what their returns were. And in probably 50% of the cases, most of the women were losing money because they didn't understand those basic concepts. And one of the underlying things I see is, if we're going to build the agricultural arena in developing countries, not just here in Africa but Latin America, what are the governments doing to educate the people to be able to understand how to improve their productivity? And what are the avenues? And how do they do hybrids? And how do they even do the bookkeeping to even know? I mean, I see this as a major aspect of the whole process, not just putting in the roads and having the right laws and so forth, but sometimes we have to go clear back to the basics. And in Nicaragua, I work with some women that are doing coffee, and many of them still don't understand where they're making their money and where they're not. And so how can that be, from your perspectives, how can that be improved as part of the whole package to improve the trade facilitation?
Is it a general question to everybody or to anybody?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Ben, okay, one more. Okay, please go ahead.
My name's Ann Lasky. I'm with the International Growth Center in Tanzania. And as we know, the AGOA agreement was just re-signed and renewed. I recently read a statistic that the original one was only exploited up to like 10% of its expected potential. And I was just wondering, what are the barriers that are preventing African nations from taking advantage of that agreement? And what needs to be done, perhaps on a coordinating level, to help them, you know, leverage agreements like AGOA and the EPA?
Any particular panelists or?
I think the peasant farmer and Bernard and maybe the deputy minister.
Okay. Okay. No, everybody will take that. Okay. Why don't we start? Then we'll take another round. I understand there's somebody here who wants to ask a question. Should we take that question? Okay. After that, we'll get the panelists.
Thank you. Thank you for remembering me. My name is Charles Okumu, Bungala Zalendo. Okay, mine is just an issue raised on basically on Africa, because I tend to believe that the gap between private sector and the government and common person who is a farmer, there's that big gap. That's why you have problems in Africa. And as much as we can complain, we cannot compete in the market when our house is not in order. We have been complaining about infrastructures, rules and regulations, policy makings. These are all are supposed to be done by the government and the goodwill of the people. But you cannot also focus on private sector, because private sector comes with their own goal and objectives. If their objectives and goals are not met, particular region, they have to fly out. I tend to believe that even though the transformation in Africa is currently big, is coming in through the private sector, but I try to encourage Africa to intertrade so that we can see how we can attack the other continent. Without that, we shall be just having agreement, complaints here and there until I don't know which year. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you. Before I give it to the panelists, I think there's something, an issue that keeps coming up in many of the questions. Basically, what should we prioritize? Should we go TFA globally, or should we do TFA to promote intra-African trade first before worrying about the global trade facilitation? So if any of the panelists can also address that, that I would appreciate. So we'll start with the minister, then we'll go to Bernard, then we go to Lucy. Oh, Bernard will go last, okay. Okay, we got 7 minutes. Okay, why don't we just go along in terms of sitting order? Okay.
Okay, thank you very much, and thank you for all those very relevant questions and observations. Just a few observations from my side. Yeah, to raise productivity, you definitely need basic skills and all kinds of skills, and education, of course, is crucial. We don't see this only in Africa, but in many countries, education and productivity go very much hand in hand with each other. So if you look to also what we do from the Netherlands, we very much also within our agricultural activities in Africa, we pay a lot of attention to basic skills and education. It's very much education in terms of maybe kind of economical educations, or but also very much on the production side, to work with fertilizers, and that really needs a lot of skills and education. So we put a lot of effort from our Dutch side, and also what our Dutch companies do in Africa, if they work very closely together with small farmers, they educate them as well and share their knowledge and expertise with the small farmers, so they also are learning how to farm, but also to upgrade their requirements for products and standards in order to be able to export to countries in the end, also to a European market. So that is very, very crucial. The issue of inter-African trade, if you look to the trade costs within Africa, sometimes they are very much larger than trade costs between Africa and another continent. And that, of course, is a strange thing. Distance still very much matters. So if you have large trade costs with your neighboring country, or even if you go to the market in the next village or city, then you really have a problem. So I think in that respect, trade costs, to lower trade costs, and also TFA within Africa or within African countries is extremely relevant. At the same time, I also see successes of farmers in Africa also exporting to European markets, so outside Africa. So I'm not sure whether you have to choose between one or the other, but if you look to trade costs within African countries and within the African region, there is a lot of opportunity to lower them and gives a lot of trade opportunities within African countries, within African regions. So thank you.
Thank you. The first thing I would say is that the agro industry in Africa is hampered by chicken and egg situation. Who do you put first, the processing or the farming? I mean, most of the people who have processing plants in Ghana are running the processing plants 2 or 3 months in a year because there isn't enough production. So, and this is something which calls directly for government intervention. Because if you put in the processing plant, somebody has to make sure that there is enough agricultural produce to feed the processing. The next point is about the low ratification of the TFA. I think that just because TFA came from the WTO, it is suffering some of the reputation problems of the WTO. If we will be honest amongst ourselves, the WTO, especially in Africa and in the developing world, doesn't have the best of reputations. So people are not even looking at it. I mean, because of this, when I went to read it, I said, but these are all good things for Africa and for trading. So why aren't governments ratifying it? I think there's a reputational problem because of where it's coming from. The next point I'd like to make is about the educating the farmers, the lady from Iowa. Yes. You know, before economic liberalization of the 80s, you know, we had people like extension officers in Ghana whose jobs it was to go teach the farmers, help them to keep books, help them to make simple bookkeeping. All those people were chucked out of the system as part of the economic liberalization problem. We are now recognizing that they were very useful because they brought improved seeds, improved varieties, farming methods, and education on farming, accounting, and all that. So that is a gap which is still got to be filled. And again, it is only government policy which can do that. People like me may go into farming, but how many people will we get a critical mass of people like myself who will go into farming in enough across the continent? That is a very, very big question. The point about AGOA, let me say that we didn't take maximum advantage of AGOA due primarily to some of the trade facilitation issues. There was a study in Ghana, Kenya, and I think Botswana, about garment manufacturing under AGOA. And it showed that at the factory floor level, the cost of manufacturing garments in these three African countries matched what was being done in China. But then, when the environmental costs, if you like, got added to it, the Chinese were far more competitive than the African garment producers. And I have direct experience of it because I closed down what was at one time the biggest garment manufacturing operation in Ghana. I had over 400 workers because we were not making money from the operation. But that is another story. Maybe one day I'll talk about it. And finally, trade facilitation, whether it's intra-Africa, within Africa, or between Africa and the world, it helps either way. It is useful, so we should look at improving it. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to add on the peasant farmer contribution on AGOA. Just last month, we held a big meeting for the whole of Kenya SMEs, and the issue was around AGOA. And what we realized is that there's very little sensitization. People don't know. They think that AGOA is just about garments. When there are thousands of products that are available, you can export under the AGOA, In Kenya, we are doing less than 10 products because there's no sensitization. So that's one of the things that, one of the proceeding from the meeting about sensitizing the SMEs. We have very good representatives in this panel here doing leather, good leather products, my sister here. And we want to access the market, AGOA, with our products. I want to talk about, to go back to your, Dr. Yo, what he talked about coming with a TFA for Africa. And I still want to challenge Dr. Yo, the fact that up to now, we have our own comprehensive African agriculture development program, which is a clear program that calls for an organization way of working, and calls for mutual accountability, responsibility. And up to now, we have not been able to achieve those conditions and attribution we have had our government commit to. So how are they going to commit to the TFA even in Africa? I think it's more of the political wellness. Is it there? What should we do? I think, how can we take our government to task? And I really want we start rethinking cut up again, because every time we keep on meeting, last year they met at Malabo, where they reaffirmed again, they call it the Malabo Declaration, where they have clearly stipulated in that document, how is Africa going to fast track their agribusiness development? Where we are talking about the percentages, everything is in that document. And every time African Union is calling us for those meetings, there's NEPAD Planning Agency. I think we need to take our government, as I said, from the beginning to task. How do we ensure things that we talk about and the things that they commit to do are taken up, as even we discuss about coming with a TFA that can bring us together in Africa. And I also want to mention about the women. You know, women is a very important subject and very dear to my heart. And in front of you is our dear lady leading the African women in agribusiness for East Africa. I am very happy to say that here in Kenya, we are taking that issue for women quite seriously. And the good ambassador is our president. He has clearly come following the agreements under the New York when we met early this year, about the procurement and supporting the women in the procurement. We really want to ensure that the women don't just end up only being workers and not earners. We want to ensure that the women are supported all through. On the day before yesterday, we had this great meeting, the women meeting, and our deputy president did mention quite passionately about if you don't have the women in your team, then you never win. It's a half, the team is half. It is missing the players, the key players. So how can you win a football game? I think we need to rethink how we have to engage our women, and a very important point. Thank you very much for bringing it up. Thank you.
So just a few points on these questions. So on the ratifications and why so few ratifications, I think the perception point, I think, is very well taken. And I think it's not just, I think part of this negative perception has to do with the fact that this was actually a long negotiation. So in a sense, these are issues that make, from an objective observer's point of view, make eminent sense. But because it was part of a, you know, this negotiating mentality kind of often pollutes, I think, the atmosphere. So that, I think that's one aspect. But I think the other aspect is just a technical one, because it's quite a complicated agreement in the sense that the way you have to schedule commitments, you have to decide what do we do immediately, what do we do over a period of time, and that will require some investment, and what will we do again over a period of time, but that's where we're looking for external assistance to do that. So in terms of mapping all of that out is something you don't do overnight, right? So I think that there isn't a dimension there, which is it's technically quite complex. And then, of course, you have the parliamentary process, which doesn't always, you know, you can't immediately get parliaments to do what you think needs to be done because they have their own schedule and agenda. But I think that in addition to the perception dimension, I think the structure of the agreement also helps explain why it's taking a bit more time than many of us would like to see. On AGOA, I think It's also the case that in the agricultural sector, if you look at what AGOA offers, you know, you have tariff rate quotas. So you have still restrictions in place in sectors where Africa actually has a comparative advantage, where you don't get into the market, right? So those are excluded for political reasons in the United States. So I think that's one thing to focus on. We have sanitary phytosanitary restrictions. So again, that goes back to the capacity dimension, which is an issue. And the final thing I would mention is AGOA is, of course, really important, but at the same time, the U.S. is also giving duty-free, quota-free treatment to other countries through preferential trade agreements. So, yeah, if you think fresh flowers, you know, Colombia is a big provider of that type of product to the United States, so it's very difficult for exporters in Africa to kind of get into that market. So there's also a lot of competition. So I think AGOA is great, but at the same time, you know, the margin of preference frequently is not high enough to overcome these trade costs. So I think, again, we come back to this issue of trade costs and trade facilitation as being very important to actually use the preferential access that AGOA gives you, or that everything but arms gives you in the EU. Then one final point on Yaw's question, you know, where should the prioritization be? And I think there it's very important, I think, which has come out of this discussion, is that the trade facilitation agreement essentially deals with the external border, right? It deals with getting customs to be more efficient. But a large part of the trade facilitation agenda is intranational, intra-regional, and the trade facilitation agreement will help you in principle if there's a border involved, but often there won't be. So I think, again, the message for policy is trade facilitation is really important, but you need to really start by connecting the country itself, right? So, and of course, this certainly applies for large countries where you have individual states and provinces, where, you know, that is, I think, probably more important than what you do at the border. So I think this internal trade facilitation dimension is very important. And there the WTO is not going to help, right? So that really needs to come from the government, and that needs to be pushed by the domestic private sector, saying that's what we need to do.
Thank you, Bernard. Thank you for the rest of the panel. I think we have time for another short round of questions before we close. So I'll take one, and then behind him, and then Julius. Okay, please go ahead.
Yes, my name is Frans Lammers. I work for the OECD in Paris. I have a question to the Vice Minister, who mentioned in his introduction that a very small country, and small it takes 4 hours to travel from one side to the other, is the second largest agriculture producer. And I put to you that this is perhaps the perfect example of a successful industrial policy. Successful in the sense that farmers are united in corporations, they dialogue with the government. The government has sponsored knowledge sharing, university, but also vocational training. The farmers have access to a specialized bank, which have a AAA standing. The farmers have specific policies, tax reform, land reform, cheap energy. And then, of course, the EU agriculture policy has also very much helped. So I put it to the panel, but especially to the minister, how far do you think that this vertical integration model of basically industrial policy for agriculture good is replicable here in Africa, especially given the international rules and regulations in the WTO. Thank you very much.
Okay. Where are you from again, please?
I work for the OECD, but like the minister and Bernard Hoekman, I come from the Netherlands.
Okay, OECD, okay. Behind him?
Yeah, my name is Erudag Manning. I work for De Ruyter East Africa. We are a rose breeder with over 100 years breeding in the rose world. I've been in the business for 7 years. And one of my key questions for the panel today is the fact that as Kenya grows from LEDC into a closer MEDC economic strength and power zone, with these negotiations going through the EU into some of the trading partners such as Russia, and what is the potential for bilateral trade agreements with direct countries outside of the EU with equally strong buying power? Thank you.
Hello. My name is Julius Gatune from the Africa Center of Economic Transformation. Mine is a bit of a reflection on some of the work we have done and also pose some questions. We have done a number of value chain studies, really, about 20 in the last 2 years across 5 African countries. And interesting issues come up because really what you want is transformation. But as you transform and you upgrade the value chains, then you start getting new issues. And one issue was raised is about women, because women do a lot. In artisanal processing, for example, if you look in Ghana, where I've done most of the artisanal processing is women. But then as you start upgrading and you start having SMEs come in and start accessing newer markets, then people with resources are other people. Then you start edging them out. But in our studies, you find interesting things that actually can actually be ways of thinking about how to do integrate women as you try to upgrade and be able to trade better. And what one thing we found interesting in Ghana is one SME manufacturer decided all this hassle, as you have been told, it's very, very hard for a processor to really get supply, because supply is a problem. Much as we want to have processing in Africa, it's very, very hard to be able to put a factory there. If you look at many factories, they're operating 50%, sometimes 20% processing capacity. How do you solve that challenge? So what he found out is that women processors, really who do the artisanal processing, are able to, because some of them are farmers, they can solve the supply problem. So then how do you make the artisanal processor become kind of a subcontractor to you? So then when they process the gari, which is really a staple in that part of the world, then you supply in bulk, and the artisanal processor then becomes the person who thinks, how do I market, how do I access markets, how do I package, how do I support the woman to meet the various standards? Because regulations are always important, standards, food regulations, which very, very hard for artisanal processor to meet. So you find that this kind of model then allows this SME processor to actually get the product that is being done by women in northern Ghana to actually supermarkets in Europe, where people are looking for Africa. Because right now, supermarkets are carrying ethnic food lines, and they are becoming very profitable. In the US, you have the Africa stores where people just supply. But these are supplied by a lot of SMEs based actually in West Africa mostly, because I think West Africa still really wants their food in, even wherever they are. So that provides an interesting model, and I think that's how do you start now helping them. Because I think when we start thinking of trade facilitation, how do we then try to create these symbiotic relationships that can strengthen artisanal processor to SMB processor to the international value chain, to global supermarkets? And that's the other issue that I also want to raise up. Because last 2 weeks ago, we were in South Africa discussing the supermarket revolution. Because this is a reality in Africa. It has happened in America, in Europe, South America, but right now it's starting to take off in Africa. Supermarkets are taking over and they are restructuring the whole value chains, the whole agricultural value chains. In Kenya, we already see that. And supermarkets in Kenya, we have shown that there has been an emergence of what you call middle-class farmers or medium-sized farmers, people who are leaving their well-paying jobs and starting to go farming, basically because they resist supermarket that they can start supplying, which again, smallholder farmers can't. But again, the medium-scale farmers are able to actually subcontract the supermarket, the smaller-scale farmers. So it becomes interesting. But again, if you don't really are not careful about how you manage the emergence of supermarket value chains, then you can have a lot of people excluded. So I really want to hear the reflections from the panel about how do we manage the supermarket revolution so that it becomes more inclusive. And then also, how do we start creating a more symbiotic processing environment which does not leave the artisanal processor out?
Thank you. I think that's really the end of the questioning. I'd also like to put one last question to the panelists. This whole distinction between LDCs and the rest of the developing countries that permeates most WTO agreements. And as you heard, many people really think that we should also, whether in parallel or even prioritize, the importance of intra-African trade. How does it, and in trading among ourselves and taking advantage of some of the preferences and rules of origin, I mean, Kenya is not an LDC, Tanzania is an LDC. They are treated differently under WTO rules. How do we ensure that we are able to pursue this type of regional integration and regional trade when the WTO insists on these type of distinctions? Anyway, this is our last opportunity for you to respond to any of the questions before we wrap up. Who should we start with? We do it the same way that we did last time.
Well, thank you very much. Maybe need an hour to answer all those questions and give reactions on those observations. Maybe I'll pick two of them and the rest I'll leave for the rest of the panel. about the Dutch model. It's not the second largest producer, but the second largest exporter. Anyway, it's big for a small country like the Netherlands. Well, if you look to the Dutch model, I think it's about productivity, about export orientations, about scale, about innovation. And that all happened in a kind of a triangle between the government, the private sector, and the knowledge institutes. They work very closely together. And if you look to the private sector, we're speaking about farmers, transport firms, and private companies active in agricultural production. So it is quite a large group of private companies. And but the cooperation between those three, so to say, of the triangle is very intense, and that made it quite successful in the Netherlands. And of course, we also have a strong European policy. But looking to Europe, there are different countries, but the Netherlands particularly is extremely strong because they have such a strong cooperation between those three two. Could you copy this model to another country or to Africa? Well, I always say context extremely matters. So always very careful in copying a certain model to a different country, a different culture. You could look, however, to what made it successful in the Netherlands and are issues or aspects of that model relevant for a different context, for an African context, and can you learn from that? That's a model you could do. And part of it is, I think, happening to work with knowledge institutes. You definitely need a government assisting you. And you definitely, what is also said already by, I think, by Bernard, you have to look to the supply chain as a whole. So be careful in copying economic models from one country to the other, but you can always learn from best practices or particular aspects of a certain model. But it's very much in the Dutch model, the triangle, government, private companies, and knowledge institutions. So that's one point I would like to make. And the other, maybe it's about WTO and LDCs and DCs. Well, I think that makes it so difficult, I think, to make progress within the WTO, that maybe we see a lot of differentiation in economies of countries and interests of countries, but in the negotiations you see large group of countries. So it makes it, I think, very difficult to make progress. And I think the interests of DCs is not always the same as other developing countries. If you compare Brazil with or Brazil and China with LDCs or even with DCs in Africa, you see different positions and different interests. And that makes it, I think, extremely difficult to make progress. So any kind of, although on the one hand you see differentiations in phasing out periods or in, if you look to everything but armed initiatives, but on the other hand, on the negotiating tables, you don't see that much difference, and that makes progress very difficult. So if we could be able to really bring back the negotiations to really interests, but also to the differentiations in interests, that might be helpful in making progress. If you talk about market access, if you talk about domestic support, if you talk how to deal with SPS or technical barriers. So I think that the problem is that we are not able to differentiate enough at the negotiating tables, and that's really a problem to make progress, which is very unfortunately, because we're still hoping for a certain outcome this week. It would be extremely relevant to have an outcome and also to move forward in the WTO agenda, not only on the Doha issues but maybe also on other issues. But so let's hope for a good outcome this week, and we have a few days to work on it. Thank you.
On the farm subsidies and support for agric, yes, whilst it's true that the EU and other Western governments subsidize and support their farmers much more than is done in Africa, I think the problem is made worse, talking as a farmer, by the fact that the support we get in Africa is not well structured. So, which makes the problem even worse. I'll give you an example. I mean, my favorite example is about the tractors which our African governments buy every year. I mean, they buy large numbers of tractors, and give them to farmers at subsidized rates. They are supposed to help mechanize farming. In reality, some back of the envelope calculation we did in Ghana, if we looked at the number of tractors, subsidized tractors, which had come into the economy over the past 5 or 6 years, we could have plowed the whole country several times over. It was obvious that these tractors were not being used for farming. In the rural areas, a lot of it was being used for transport. The question we ask is that, why don't we take some of that subsidy and instead of using it for tractors, use it maybe to guarantee some minimum price for some essential crop? And we believe, and we have been saying again and again, that until we have guaranteed minimum prices for our staple foods, we are very unlikely to get to the stage where we'll produce enough or attract enough middle class knowledgeable farmers into farming. And we think that that is the kind of support which we should be aiming at. The point that Julius makes about shopping malls and their effect on agriculture in Africa. Yes, in Ghana at least, there is a big effect coming on, except that again, it's not as fast as we would like. When the shopping mall started coming into our country, we tried to get policymakers to agree that, look, let us get the shopping malls as a condition for coming in to reserve certain sizes of shelf space, certain volumes of shelf space for made in Ghana products. This will force the malls not only to look for made in Ghana products, but even to help develop those products if need be. But some of these things, policy interventions, did not take place at that time. So we could get even more advantage from having the shopping malls come in. Because the point is, you can't stop them. It is what is happening around the world. And your citizens want them anyway. So we might as well structure policy to help take advantage of them. The last point about LDCs and middle incomes is a strange one. I suppose like all economic categories, these are really artificial categories. I mean, I'll take the case of Ghana, where we woke up one morning and we heard that our economy had been rebased, whatever that means, and that as a result, we were no longer an LDC. We had become a middle-income country. Nobody in the country felt any richer. Nobody felt any better off. But somebody had decided that we had become a middle-income country. And the consequences of that were that we couldn't access certain kind of facilities from the World Bank. There were all sorts of things we couldn't do. So the private sector sat back and said, but so of what use is it for us to have become a middle-income country? And that is a question nobody has answered satisfactorily for us up to now. But essentially, I think that international institutions like the bank and like the WTO ought to take some of these things into account, that these are really artificial categorizations. And we shouldn't be so strict on who can do what. Because between an LDC and a DC, I mean, the citizens don't feel any different. Thank you.
Thank you. And I just want to reemphasize what the peasant farmer has just said there about this LDC and DC. Just the case is the same case in Kenya. We woke up one day and we were told we are a developing country. And when you go around and you see the kind of poverty level in the outskirts, just here within Nairobi, you then wonder what's the meaning of developing country. I think this is something that we need to rethink. We are actually lost. What was the meaning of developing country? And when you look at Tanzania, frankly speaking, there's more inclusivity and their model is quite different, that you won't see the kind of the deep poverty levels you find in Kenya, in Tanzania. I mean, in short, what I'm trying to say, we need to rethink and we need to understand and we need to discuss on this particular issue, quite frankly, and we need some soberness in this. It's affecting everyone. It's affecting us too, like it's affecting Ghana. When you talk about the supermarkets, I am one of the SME, and knowing how difficult it is to access supermarkets, I feel sad that, yes, there are many people who are doing nice products out there, but they still can't access their supermarkets because they can't compete, and perhaps they can't do the right the qualities that are needed. And it's really a hopeless situation because unless our governments again come and intervene, and I'm thinking loudly, how can the government come up with policies that safeguards the country's development and moving forward for the SME to be able to access and compete? We are not stopping our partners from the Western to bring their products here. We, in short, what we want, can you come and invest in our countries? Let's partner, let's add value to our products here locally. I think that will be a win-win for all of us. We are partnering, we are moving together, and we are helping to resolve the world and make it a better place for all of us to live in. Now, the other issue, we talked about the intra-trade. As far as we continue mistrusting one another in Africa, we do that. And it's a fact, let the fact be told, that our Tanzanians, our brother here, are scared of Kenyans. They think we are very aggressive. So how are we going to trade if we still have that mistrust between one another? We really need to have that trust and see one another as brothers. If we cannot work together, and then this inter-trade is just going to be a dream, yeah? And lastly, but not least, let's really work towards looking into investment opportunities for Africa. Let's ensure that we're coming up with bankable investment plans that can be able to attract our partners who we are telling, welcome, Africa is ready for business. But when you come here, they ask, where is the business? We can see some chunk of big land out there, but they don't even know where to start from. I think we need to help them. Somebody is here from Deloitte. Let's work together, Deloitte. Let's work with our other partners. Let's work with our research institutions. Let's build investment cases for attracting foreign direct investment into our countries. Thank you very much.
Thanks. Very quickly, because I know we're running out of time. On the question with respect to the Dutch model, I think one of the things I would emphasize there is it's very import-driven, right? So in a sense, there's a lot of imports coming in, getting processed, being shipped out again. And I think that is one element of the model that I think could be at least something to think about in the African context, right? Where you have the, essentially you can think of the Netherlands as one big distribution logistics center, which you don't really have. And I think that there's potential there to do that type of thing in Africa. But I think the import side is important. So you need to have very easy imports. And then a lot of our exports are essentially, a lot of the value is actually coming from other countries. So I think that's, again, this supply chain phenomenon there. On the retail point, I think that's a very important one. And I think it illustrates, again, that you shouldn't just think about trade facilitation in terms of getting stuff onto export markets. It's very much getting local, satisfying local demand, right? And I think what we've seen, a lot of the supermarkets, they would much rather source locally than import, right? So in terms of, this also goes back to the question with respect to enhancing capacity of local farmers. A lot of the big retailers actually, because the incentive to source locally is so strong, they are willing to actually invest in helping to ensure that they get the quality from local suppliers. So I think that's another dimension, which again has nothing to do with trade facilitation. It's really all about efficient import substitution. So I think that again is something that is an important point to make. So I agree with that. Finally, on the LDC question, I think that really is a big problem, right? Because it is artificial. It's something that we have in the WTO. But of course, if you're engaged in a regional integration arrangement with LDCs and non-LDCs, all you're really doing is breaking up the effort to integrate those regional markets. So that, I think, is a negative externality. But at the same time, I also think there's quite a lot that could be done by the importing countries right? Because a lot of this is unilateral policy. There is nothing that prevents the European Union or the United States from giving the same treatment they give to an LDC to Kenya, right? And I think that really is, and we have that in AGOA, right? To a much greater extent than that we have it with respect to the European Union. So I would again say push that argument. Yeah, so again, that then boils down also into how you apply rules of origin and accumulation. There's a lot of this technical stuff, which really, I think, inhibits trade, where that's what I would be pushing on with respect to kind of the export markets in terms of facilitating that regional integration.
Okay, thank you. So how do we use the trade facilitation agreement to leverage agricultural transformation as part of the broader role of transforming African economies? As we've heard, the trade facilitation agreement is good in itself, but it has to be embedded in the whole supply development of the supply chain. And a lot of questions have come into how do you increase productivity and solve all the constraints in agricultural production. As an advanced promotion, my institution, Africa Center for Economic Transformation, ASET, we are our next report, which will be in about in the fall, September or so, 2016, is going to be precisely on how you transform agriculture, where we are going to try to address or at least try to answer many of the questions that came in terms of land tenureships, mechanization, regional integration in terms of farming, irrigation, and all these other things. And we hope that that work can then help complement how we take advantage of trade facilitation to leverage agricultural transformation in Africa. Let me, on behalf of you, thank profusely our esteemed panel for spending the time and giving us their insight. So if you join me in giving a big hand to the panel. Thank you. Thank you so much, and also I would like to express my appreciation and thanks for the audience for coming in to listen, to contributing your views, and remaining engaged. Thank you so much for coming. Thanks. And lastly, also for TDSC for helping organize this thing, and the Netherlands for helping us jointly put this together. Thank you.